On the one hand, I feel like we're never going to know who the Zodiac Killer was. It's just going to be one of those mysteries of our time. But on the other, it's probably Ted Cruz. Exhibit A, he just tried to run away to Mexico. Hi, everyone. I'm Bolton.
And I'm Grace.
And welcome to Crime Scenes, a true crime movie podcast. So what movie are we doing today, Grace?
Today we are doing Zodiac.
I know we've been away for a while, and that is because the recap of this movie was no easy feat, but it was worth it. So this recap is actually going to be a couple of firsts for us. This is our first request. The request was made by our friend from Tulane, Caitlin Corcoran. And this is going to be our first two-parter. So we're going to roughly recap the first half of the movie this week, and then we will do the second half of the movie next week. Also, we wanted to make this announcement at the beginning. We now have merch, which is available on our website, and you can get the link to that on our Instagram at Crime Scenes Pod. We've got t-shirts, tank tops, mugs, beach towels, and stickers. And we also now have a Buy Me a Coffee. So if you want to support us, then we would greatly appreciate it. You can do that at buymeacoffee.com, which there's also a link to that on our Instagram. And we'll talk about that a little bit more at the end. Alrighty, let's go.
Dear editor, this is the murderer of the two teenagers last Christmas at Lake Herman and the girl on the 4th of July.
I want you to print this cipher on the front page of your paper.
He wants his code in the afternoon edition.
Graysmith, don't you have a cartoon to finish?
The Zodiac Killer has come to San Francisco.
Another letter.
School children make nice targets.
He gave himself a name.
Greek, Morse code, astrological signs. This guy's used them all.
I like killing people because man is the most dangerous animal of all.
How does one do that?
I like puzzles. I do them a lot.
Got any hard suspects?
About 90 an hour. I'm up to around 500.
You got four crime scenes. Not a single usable print. You can't think of this case in normal police terms.
He's breaking the pattern.
Lena said you were a cartoonist.
Oh, yeah.
What are you doing at the gun range?
I just want to help.
What are you, some kind of Boy Scout?
Eagle Scout, actually. First class.
Well, I've been thinking.
Oh, God, save us all.
There's no evidence, Robert.
What do you mean there's no evidence? You have him seen with the ciphers, the military boot prints, the bloody knife.
All circumstantial.
Why do you need to do this?
Because nobody else will.
Dave, you made a mistake!
Get away from the window.
Paul, are you okay?
No.
Why'd you do it? You put your face out there for him to see.
Hello? Who is this?
Zodiac was my job. It is not yours.
He's still out there, Dave.
Killing is his compulsion. It drives him. It's in his blood.
Jeez.
What?
Squirrels.
This is the Zodiac speaking.
I have a gun.
I can give you a lift to the service station.
Do you always go around helping people in the night?
I'm not the Zodiac. And if I was, I certainly wouldn't tell you.
Are you sure there's nobody else in the house?
Feel it in the air. It's there everywhere.
You can watch this movie on Amazon Prime. If you've got an account, it is free, or you can buy or rent it. It's also available on Crackle for free, but I believe it's going to have commercials if you watch it there. A little movie overview. This is starring Jake Gyllenhaal, Mark Ruffalo, Robert Downey Jr., and Anthony Edwards. Anthony Edwards, if you're familiar with ER, is Dr. Green. It's directed by David Fincher. It's written by James Vanderbilt, and it's based on the 1986 nonfiction book of the same title by Robert Graysmith. This film tells us about the manhunt for the Zodiac Killer, a serial murderer who terrorized the San Francisco Bay Area during the late 1960s and 70s, taunting police with letters, bloodstained clothes, ciphers, all mailed to the newspaper. The case remains open and is one of the most infamous unsolved crimes.
This movie is a little long. It's 2 hours and 37 minutes, so you're going to want to have a good chunk of time if you're sitting down for it. But it's like a good Saturday morning, Saturday night movie.
Actually, I was going to say at the beginning of this, obviously, this is about a serial killer, so the content's going to be pretty dark. But the director, David Fincher, does a really good job of adding, I don't want to call it comic relief, but it kind of is in a very appropriate way that's not offensive to victims. It's more through the chemistry of the actors that are working together. So you've got journalist characters, which are going to be Robert Downey Jr. and Jake Gyllenhaal's characters, just having these weird moments in the office that you know everybody has every day. And then you've also got the same thing with Mark Ruffalo and Anthony Edwards' characters. And they're very little things. They're not taking away from the movie, but they just make it less dark and makes it much more watchable, which is why I really like this movie. If you're concerned about something being too dark, I think this movie is a better thing to watch than our movie last week, Foxcatcher. But still watch Foxcatcher. I did not know this, but the director, David Fincher, the writer, and the producer all spent about 18 months conducting their own investigation and research into the Zodiac murders before making this movie, which worked out well for them because this is considered one of the most historically accurate films. Our sources are obviously going to be the movie itself. It's from 2007. Grace looked through Zodiac by Robert Graysmith, published in 1986, which is the book that this movie is based on. I looked through Zodiac Unmasked, also by Robert Graysmith, which was published in 2002. It's kind of an update to it. There's also a really great podcast, I'm sure a lot of people out there have heard it, called Monster the Zodiac Killer. It is a podcast by iHeartRadio and Tenderfoot TV. If you're familiar with Payne Lindsay, that's his media network empire that he has, and it's hosted by Matt Frederick. I also looked at a website called ZodiacKillerFacts.com, which was created by Mike Butterfield. It looks very antiquated. I think it's been around since 1998, but it's got some great information. It's got all the old reports, it's got pictures, it's got all the letters. When I stopped being a lawyer, I was like, I'm not looking at a police report ever again. And what was I doing this morning but looking through fucking police reports? Never stops, ever. So that's something interesting if you just want to flip through stuff too. A few things about this movie before we start. Although it has been praised for its historical accuracy, it is based primarily on the research done for one book, and that's the book by Robert Graysmith. As a result, I did find sources and people talking about how they don't agree with everything that Graysmith says. Some of these things range from saying that he put completely fictionalized information into the book to he just is only scratching the surface. He's not going in deep enough. One of the big things is that Robert Graysmith's book and the movie predominantly focus on one suspect, and they really are pointing you in the direction that that is the guy, when the reality is there are some other people and there are more weaknesses to this guy as a suspect. However, we could sit here and talk about this for years. At some point, we're just going to have to streamline this information. So for the most part, here's what we're going to do as we recap this. We're going to primarily follow the movie's plot and add the correct facts or discuss things that were not included based on the storyline presented. We're not going to jump off the movie timeline to go to something totally different if it's just going to make it too confusing. Luckily, the movie does go in chronological order, so that's going to make this a lot easier. Second thing we're going to do, we're only going to be talking about the confirmed victims of the Zodiac Killer. The Zodiac Killer ultimately claimed to have killed 37 people. There are 7 confirmed people that the Zodiac Killer attacked and 5 people he did murder. So we're going to primarily focus on the evidence from those cases. Alrighty, let's get into this. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. Side note, my notes are 56 pages long.
Bolton. I thought mine were long because they're like 13 and usually I try to stick to like 7. I love it.
I think we need to start keeping track of what the movies say at the beginning, because we've gotten so far what you're fixing to see is based on real events. We've gotten the following is based on true events. That's pretty boring. And then what follows is based on actual case files. So this is a new one.
Yeah.
And we also open up with some great music that takes you straight into the late 60s, early 70s. It's a song called Easy to Be Hard by Three Dog Night. How can people be so heartless? How can people be so cruel? It's so perfect because it's such a sweet song that fits into the ambiance, that also we're about to hear about a lot of people that were heartlessly killed.
Yeah.
So we get some on-screen text that says July 4th, 1969, and we're in Vallejo, California. We're driving through what appears to be a regular neighborhood just celebrating the 4th of July. And this is going to be our introduction to Darlene Farren and Michael Mageau. We see a young girl, that's going to be Darlene Farren, and she's picking up a guy. And apparently he's been waiting for her for a while.
Where have you been? I've been waiting since 7.
Get in, I have to find fireworks.
The reality is, in this case, Darlene picks up Michael Mageau at about 11 p.m. They had initially made plans to meet way earlier, starting first at like 4 p.m. in the afternoon and then later at 7. A little background on Darlene that we probably need to address is she was 22. She was married with a kid, but she was notoriously a social butterfly. Mm-hmm. She worked at a local pancake house as a waitress, and that's actually where she met her husband. And he was interviewed in one of the sources that I looked at, and he, all in all, seemed like a nice guy. But he even said in his own words that Darlene was very social. She had a lot of guy friends. And he says that despite their good relationship, he would like to believe that she was not having any extramarital affairs, but he couldn't necessarily say for sure.
Yeah.
And this was kind of the case with Michael Mageau. It's not clear whether or not they were in a relationship, but as the husband puts it, I couldn't rule it in, I couldn't rule it out.
From Robert Graysmith's book, it seemed very much like when people talk to the husband, a common response he would give is, she's young, she's got to get it out of her system, let her go out and party and do things. He didn't really seem to mind. Like you said, their relationship was good, and so it was kind of like, I'm gonna not think about it and just go on living.
I feel like people, in all the research I did, they really tiptoe around this subject. Like, they're afraid that by mentioning that she was married and potentially had relationships with other people, that it's being insensitive to her. The only reason I want to talk about this is because there's some information in this that's going to come up later. And what is about to happen is a very specific pattern for the Zodiac Killer. So they were there very likely being a couple.
Yeah.
We see Darlene and Michael, and they go off to an area that is called Blue Rock Springs, and it's a lover's lane.
What do we get?
Sitting, listening to music, talking.
And I hate that term. I cannot stand it. I just freaking don't like it. They're sitting there and it's just kind of them talking. Then all of a sudden you see a guy come park up behind them. You can't really see what he looks like. In reality, he actually pulled up next to them, and Michael thinks he might have seen the car before.
Was that car the driver? I saw that car, Mr. Benson. Do you want me to tell him to leave?
Stay in the car.
Darlene appears very worried, almost like she knows the person. And Michael even asks her,
was that your husband?
No.
Who was that, Darlene?
The car quickly drives off. We have no clue who it is. They sit there a little worried, and Darlene kind of plays it off like it wasn't a big deal or anything. And she did this in real life. Michael Mageau, in his interview later, would tell police that he did ask her, did you know that person? And she would tell him, oh, it's nothing, I know everybody. But because she literally did know so many people, it was not clear if she really did know him or not. He could not tell. In the movie, it's about 30 seconds later, you hear tires screeching, and that car comes up and parks back behind him again. In reality, it was about 10 minutes later. The car parks behind them. Somebody gets out, and in both real life and the movie, Michael Mageau starts telling Darlene,
get your wallet.
Get your wallet out. He thinks it's a police officer. Right. We see someone get out of the car walking with purpose. It looks like they know what they're doing. You would think it was a cop. And the other thing about this scene is the lighting is so bright from this car parked behind them. You can't really see what the car looks like. You can't see what the guy looks like. It's all in shadow. And as this person walks up to the side of the car, he walks up to the passenger side where Michael is sitting in the seat. Michael looks right at him and says,
man, you really creeped us out.
In real life, he didn't say anything. He just looked up at him like he was expecting to see a cop, and immediately the guy shoots at him. He shot 5 shots into the car. Then we see the guy walk away and go back to his car. Michael Mageau was still alive, and he describes it as, I don't remember if I was screaming from pain or if I was screaming because I was yelling at the guy for shooting us, but I started to climb over the back seat. Like, he was freaking out. He was kind of in shock. And when he started to do that, this person kind comes back and shoots both of them two times each. And then he gets back in the car and drives away and the screen goes black. So you are just like, what is happening? It's mm-hmm. not a robbery. It's not anyone we know at this point. She said she didn't know him, but she did look nervous. You don't know what's going on. The scene comes back up and we see that now Michael Mageau has managed to get himself out of the car and he's sitting on the side of the car and he's bleeding. Doesn't look good. As we see Michael Mageau sitting there, we see a motorcycle come up. It's a cop and he's come to help him. What actually happens is a little bit later, three teenagers are going to go into this lover's lane and they're going to find Michael Mageau and Darlene Farron. They call the police. They take them to the hospital. Darlene is declared dead on arrival at the hospital. She never is conscious or makes any statements. Michael Mageau does live. And about 2 minutes after they are discovered and taken to the hospital at 12:40 a.m., there is a call received by a dispatcher at the Vallejo Police Department. So someone has called 911 and we hear this 911 call and we're hearing this call as we see that Michael Mageau is actually still alive sitting by this car being found.
Vallejo Police Department.
I want to report a double murder.
May I have your
if you
name
go 1 mile east on Columbus Parkway, the public park, you'll find kids in a brown car. They were shot with a 9mm Luger. I also killed those kids last year. Goodbye.
They made this call on July 5th, 1969 at 12:40 a.m. Police traced it to a phone booth at a gas station, and it was about 0.3 miles from Darlene's home, and it was only a few blocks from the Vallejo Police Department. Now, when Michael Mageau lived, he was able to be interviewed by the police while he was in the hospital, and he gives them a description of what he saw. The movie's going to lead you to believe that he got a very good look at him. That's not mm-hmm. necessarily the case. Mike Mageau described his attacker as a 26 to 30 year old, 195 to 200 pounds, possibly even more. He said he was about 5'8" and he was a white male with light curly brown hair. So this murder that I just told you where Darlene Farron was killed and Michael Mageau was attacked, but he did in fact live. We're going to call this the Blue Rock Springs murder or murder number two. Now, why is this murder number two? I said we were going in chronological order and I'm immediately jumping from murder number one. Do not worry. We are going to get to murder number one in just a second. Don't panic. Oh, by the way, for anybody that's into behind the scenes production stuff, all of the blood was done with computers after the fact because David Fincher did not want to deal with cleaning it all up.
Oh, and wow. That's awesome.
So all the blood was added in later. Now we get some more on-screen text 4 weeks later in San Francisco. It is July 31st, 1969. And this is where we are introduced to one of our main characters. This is Robert Graysmith. He's played by Jake Gyllenhaal. And he's getting ready for work. He's getting his kid ready for school. And you can see he's kind of a little all over the place. We're getting some context here that he's divorced. The kid's mom is not in the picture.
I also want to say, just as a side note, this is another great car movie. We've had a couple great car movies. These 70s era cars are just, I love them.
I'm glad you do. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you noticed this, but they timed us out a little wrong because this is supposed to be July 31st and he's taking his kid to school.
That's true.
That's too early. After Graysmith drops his kid off at school in the middle of summer, we see him walking into the San Francisco Chronicle. And this is going to be one of our main locations that we see people at throughout the movie. And we get a really cool parallel that as Robert Graysmith is going into work at the Chronicle, you see the mail coming in at the same time. So it's right. showing you that the mail is going to be basically a character in and of itself in this movie. Mm-hmm. And as the mail is being pushed down the hall, Robert Graysmith is running down the hall to get up the elevator. As the mail is going up in the elevator, Robert Graysmith is going up in the elevator. And at one point, we get a shot of a very specific envelope in the mail. It is this blue ink, and it's addressed weird. It's not addressed like a letter you or I would write. It says SF Chronicle, San Fran Calif, please rush to editor, exclamation point. So it just looks weird and you notice it sitting right on the top.
Yeah.
As Graysmith gets in, he's called into an editorial meeting. And at the same time, you also see that a secretary has picked up all the mail for the Chronicle and she's going through that mail. And we see the secretary take a second glance at this envelope that we've just seen coming up and it kind of gives her pause. As Robert Graysmith going into this meeting, we learn a little bit more about him. He was a political cartoonist at the San Francisco Chronicle. He was not a reporter at all. He began working there in 1968. And based on watching Graysmith in the scene when he's talking to his boss and going into this meeting, he's okay at his job. He's not fantastic. He's just kind of getting by.
Yeah. The editor's looking at his drawings and says,
All right. Now,
so horrid. All right, I'm thinking we go with not so horrid.
Yeah, so he's showing up every day. We also meet another important character, and this is going to be Paul Avery, and he is played by Robert Downey Jr. You see very quickly in this scene that apparently in at least the San Francisco Chronicle office, there is a distinct line between cool kids in the office and nerds. And Paul Avery is one of the cool kids. He's talking to the boss like they're good friends and they're making jokes.
Paul, what's on the crime beat?
Janice in Datebook left the fondue party before everyone got naked.
That's a crime.
Just seen her. Wouldn't kid you.
Maybe the beginning of a crime wave.
Paul Avery actually joined the San Francisco Chronicle in 1959. And this is really weird. He left with his family in the second half of the 1960s. So like about 65 or so. And he was in Vietnam for 3 years and created his own media organization in Vietnam and in East Asia. And then eventually he came back in 1969. So he had just gotten back to being at the San Francisco Chronicle around this time. There's going to be a lot of names and a lot of stuff thrown around in this. So just to ease people's minds, Paul Avery and Robert Graysmith are the two people from the San Francisco Chronicle you need to know about. So after we meet Paul Avery, that secretary we saw opening the weird letter in the blue ink, she comes marching in with purpose and tells the editor,
"You need to see this."
The editor starts reading it and he says,
"Go get the publisher."
Now, we don't know what this letter is or what it says, but at this point, we just know that it's serious. Flip to the very next scene, and we see this letter being read out loud. The person reading this is the publisher, and the editor and the main staff are all sitting around. What was supposed to be a regular meeting has now turned into something real strange.
"Dear editor, this is the murderer of the two teenagers last Christmas at Lake Herman and the girl on the 4th of July near the golf course in Vallejo. To prove I killed them, I shall state some facts which only I and the police know. Christmas, brand name of ammo, Super X. 10 shots were fired. The boy was on his back with his feet to the car. The girl,
And it's very disturbing. Even the publisher, you notice him, he starts reading into it and he can't finish it. It's freaking him out too much. So he hands it to the editor to continue reading it.
The girl was on her right side, feet to the west. 4th of July. 1. Girl was wearing patterned slacks. The boy was also shot in the knee. Brand name of ammo was Western."
Just to clarify, because they broke up who was reading each part of the letter just now, the letter has listed out that whoever is writing this is a murderer, that he murdered some people at Christmas of 1968 that involved a boy and a girl, and that he is also claiming responsibility for the July 4th murder in 1969, the murder that we just saw a couple scenes ago. Then he ends the letter with some information and some instructions.
"Here is part of a cipher. The other two parts of this cipher are being mailed to the editors of the Vallejo Times and SF Examiner. I want you to print this cipher on the front page of your paper. In this cipher is my identity. If you do not print this cipher by the afternoon of Fry, 1st of Aug 69, I will go on a kill rampage Fry night. I will cruise around all weekend killing lone people in the night."
And then the letter finishes by saying that he will keep killing until he kills a dozen people over the weekend. And it's not signed. It just has a weird symbol at the end that is a circle with a cross in it. And Paul Avery points out,
"Is it me? Does that look like a gun sign?"
And in the movie, they get the letter right word for word. That's actually what the letter said. And we'll actually see like shots of the letter, and they are very accurate to what the letters actually looked like. There's reproductions of the letters in Robert Graysmith's book. So I think they had access to copies of them so they could make these look accurate for the movie. So it's pretty crazy that you're looking at the Zodiac letter.
Yeah, it's very eerie and very real. This letter that has been sent is one of three letters. One was sent to the San Francisco Chronicle, one was sent to the San Francisco Examiner, and one was sent to the Vallejo Times Herald, all on July 31st, 1969. And each of those newspapers got 1/3 of a cipher. Now, when I say cipher, most people who know Zodiac know what that means, but basically it is just a square of a bunch of symbols, and you can translate those into English and it will say something. Mm-hmm. And what the letter has explained is that when you combine all three of these ciphers that each newspaper has gotten, it's going to create one big 408 character cipher. And this is the first one we receive. We'll call this the 408 cipher, or cipher number one. And before we go any farther, I'm going to go back, I'm going to stop, and we're going to talk about murder number one now. I told you we'd get back to murder number one. And that is this Christmas murder that was referenced in the letter. And it says Christmas, but it actually happened on December 20th, 1968. This murder involved Betty Lou Jensen and David Faraday. Betty Lou was 16, David Faraday was 17. They were both in high school. They were actually on their first date, and this was in Benicia, California. So this is just outside the city limit of Vallejo. They go on their first date, they start at a restaurant, go by a friend's house. David had promised that he would have Betty Lou home by 11 p.m. And at about 10:15, they went and they parked at a lover's lane called Lake Herman Road. They were there for a little bit, and the reason that I think the movie does not mention this murder first or show us a scene of this murder is because we don't really know what happened. Like, we know the second murder and the ones after that. Initially, it was a woman that lived nearby found the bodies of these two people, and she called the police. Later, Robert Graysmith in his book is going to postulate that the Zodiac, this person, pulls up to the car and he makes them think that it is a robbery. So he orders them out of the car, and David Faraday gets out of the car, and just as he's halfway out of the car, the killer, who now obviously this is Zodiac, he shoots him immediately in the head and he dies. Betty Lou Jensen starts to run, and she is shot 5 times in the back, and she falls 28 feet from the car. They both were shot with a 22 caliber with Western ammo.
That one seems like it would be more gory to watch too, just based on that she was running from him. And then I guess it kind of makes you wonder if he took his lesson from that one to the next one and just shot them right away. But with the first one with David Faraday and Betty Lou Jensen, I had a quote from a sheriff who said it was an exceptionally gruesome case of double murder.
And initially, the police did, in fact, think this was a robbery gone wrong. It wasn't until a little later, when the July 4th murder happened, murder number two, that they started to realize the similarities in these two murders. And they had just started working together to see if maybe the same person had committed these crimes. And that was right at the time that this letter came to the San Francisco Chronicle and the Examiner and the Vallejo Times Herald. So that is what murder number one is. Murder number one is the Lake Herman Road murder. Murder number two is July 4th murder, Blue Rock Springs. Back to the movie. After this letter has been read out loud, they don't know if what this killer is saying is even true. They get Paul Avery to go call the Vallejo Police Department and determine, are these murders even real? Is this a real person? What is this?
Hi, this is Paul Avery from the San Francisco Chronicle. I'm looking for someone to shed some light on a letter we received. Thank you.
Sergeant Mullenix.
Sergeant Paul Avery from the San Francisco Chronicle. I just want to check if you had an unsolved firearm-related homicide on Christmas and maybe one on July 4th.
Shit. You guys got one too.
So not only is this real, we also confirm that letters did in fact go over to the San Francisco Examiner and the Vallejo Times Herald. Everything that has been explained in this letter is actually accurate, and it's all things not told to the public yet. The only people that know this are the killer and the police departments that are investigating it. At this point, the question presents itself, what do they do now with this letter, with this cipher? And the editors and the publishers are having a big debate, and everyone seems to forget that Robert Graysmith is still in this meeting.
Graysmith, don't you have a cartoon to finish?
Oh, yeah.
Technically, he doesn't have to be there anymore. He's turned in his cartoons, but you can see he's very interested in what's going on, and he's making this copy of the cipher for himself to figure out. And ultimately, what the San Francisco Chronicle decides to do is that they're going to publish their letter and the cipher on page 4 of their newspaper. They don't want to do it on the front page because they don't want to give this guy the satisfaction of doing what he wants, but they also don't want people to get hurt. All the newspapers in some form are going to do this exact same thing. They also include an article next to it with the chief of the Vallejo Police Department saying that they're not satisfied that the letter was written by the murderer, and they request whoever did send the letter to send another letter providing more facts and identifying themselves. After this decision is made, we hear Paul Avery joke.
What do you say, 20 bucks, whoever cracks the psycho's name?
20 bucks to the person who gets the guy's name first, who solves the cipher first. And Robert Graysmith, in a very little voice, like he's not very important in this world, says,
he won't keep his name.
And it's almost like he's stepping way out of place by challenging Paul Avery. And they all look at him and are like, don't you have other stuff to do? Who are you? And it just reiterates this whole Robert Graysmith was absolutely not a cool kid. So at this time, the cipher gets published and it's also sent to various law enforcement agencies. And we see the cipher in a really cool little montage being passed around to these different agencies with the heads of these agencies explaining more information about the cipher and what it is and what it looks like and how it could have possibly been created. So we start with the Naval Intelligence Center.
All right, people, listen up. The cipher is broken into three sections, each with 8 lines and 17 symbols.
Then the FBI.
No breaks between the symbols denoting different words. No numbers or clues to substitution keys.
Then the CIA.
And you got symbols from at least 7 different sources. Greek, Morse code, maybe semaphore, weather symbols, astrological signs.
And all of these agencies are super intense, but none of them are the ones to solve the cipher first. The people that solve the cipher first are a couple that we see sitting in their breakfast nook in Salinas, California. And I love it so much because it's a husband and a wife. Their names are Donald and Betty Harden. And Donald looks over at Betty and says,
"Hey, take a gander at this code thing."
Okay.
You want to give it a go?
Like, it is just another day at the office that they're just going to solve a puzzle together, which reminds me so much of my grandparents. They do crossword puzzles like there is no tomorrow. I hate crossword puzzles. They make me feel like an idiot. But my grandma does one every single morning. Like, they have books and books and books of them. Aww. So these two take a gander at the 408 character cipher number one. I actually listened to something where the daughter talked about her parents. Donald Harden was a history teacher and he was really good at puzzles, but it was almost like he was easily distracted.
Yeah.
But Betty was very good about keeping him on point. So they worked and worked and worked on this. Ultimately, Don had to go to bed because he had to go teach in the morning. But he goes, he teaches, he comes home and he said, "I wasn't very surprised, but there was no dinner ready." And she was like, "Hey, come on, keep helping me." And on August 7th, 1969, they are the first two people to solve it in 3 days. And just to add to more controversy and flair to all of this, at some point, they solved it so fast that people started suspecting Donald Harden of being the killer, because why would he solve this so fast? That gets brushed under very quickly, but it just shows it could be anybody. So then back to the San Francisco Chronicle, we actually see Paul Avery come up to Robert Graysmith, and he's kind of introducing himself. He's interested to know more about Robert Graysmith and who he is and what his deal is. And we learn that the reason he's so interested is because the cipher at this point has been solved. And as Robert Graysmith predicted, he did not give his name in the cipher. And we have Robert Graysmith read the cipher to us out loud.
"I like killing people because it is so much fun. It is more fun than killing wild game in the forest, because man is the most dangerous animal of all. To kill something gives me the most thrilling experience. It is even better than getting your rocks off with a girl. The best part of it is that when I die, I will be reborn in paradise. Then all that I have killed will become my slaves."
Robert Graysmith is so engrossed in this puzzle, and he notices immediately two things about the cipher. The first thing he notices is that there are still 18 characters remaining in the cipher that have not been solved.
"What is that at the bottom?"
"Leftovers, maybe an anagram."
It's at the very end of the cipher. There are a bunch of gibberish. They make no sense. Mm-hmm. So Robert Graysmith is writing them out, immediately trying to figure out, what does this say? The second thing Graysmith notices is that the cipher makes reference to man being a dangerous animal.
"Dangerous animal. Dangerous animal. Oh, what dangerous animal? How do I know that?"
And it's like on the tip of his tongue. He knows that that is from somewhere. And he's trying to remember, where have I heard this before? But before he can figure that out, Paul Avery is called into an editor's meeting. So we, the viewer, follow Paul Avery back into another editor's meeting. And it is because another letter has arrived. And they have the letter in the movie arrive at the San Francisco Chronicle. In real life, there was a fourth letter. If we're counting our first three identical letters as letters 1, 2, and 3, a fourth letter did arrive, but it went to the San Francisco Examiner. Why he chose to go to the Examiner, I don't know, because the purpose of the letter was to respond to that article that was published in the Chronicle asking for more information about the writer of this letter and more information about how he can prove he is the murderer. But he wrote it. It came in on August 4th, 1969. And this is also the first letter where this writer is going to refer to himself as the Zodiac. This letter, along with all the others that he sends, are going to start with, "This is the Zodiac speaking." So that is how the Zodiac killer got his name. He named himself. And then immediately after we see this letter come in, we are now at a different scene, and it is a couple, and their names are Cecilia Shepherd and Brian Hartnell. They were college students, and the place where they're at is Lake Berryessa State Park. It's in Napa, California. And basically, they were just at this park having a picnic. It shows them again as being a romantic couple. Their families were pretty adamant that they were just friends.
Yeah.
I think it's really the point that the Zodiac was going after people that were couples because although the crimes weren't sexual in nature, he got off killing people that were couples.
Yeah.
You also may notice that they are right by water. And that was another thing initially the Zodiac killer kept doing. All of these places he was going, either there was water mentioned in the name or they were in proximity to water, but here it's very obvious they are right by a lake. And what happens is it is actually Cecilia Shepherd that notices someone sitting in a tree, and he comes down out of the tree walking towards them.
Somebody else is here.
It is a public park.
I think he's watching us.
Well, we're very good looking.
Where'd he go? Right behind that tree.
All right, so he's taking a leak.
And they're too far away to see their face. Then we see Cecilia telling Brian, hey, this guy's getting closer.
He's coming towards us.
And then she says,
oh my God, he has a gun.
And we see him close up, but he is wearing a full-on medieval executioner style outfit. It's got all black on. There is a white circle with a cross that looks like a gun sight that we saw in all the letters on his chest. He is wearing a completely covered hood over his head. And Brian Hartnell would later describe this as he was wearing one pair of glasses, then he had holes in the hood, then another pair of glasses. Like, you could not see what he looked like. He did say, however, that there was a little bit of brown hair poking out of the bottom of the hood. And before he put the hood on, he thought he saw brown hair. This person comes up and he is telling them,
don't move. I want your money and your car keys.
Okay. We're not going to do anything, okay? We're going to cooperate. Just tell me what you want us to do.
And they're immediately compliant. They throw their stuff over to him, and it's not funny, but it just shows the panic in someone that Brian is like offering to write him a check.
If there's anything else I could do for you, maybe I could write you a check. Okay, I could give you my phone number.
Just the panic in that moment, I would not even handle it that well. I would absolutely have been shitting myself.
Yeah. I also liked, as we both are sociology pre-law majors, I really enjoyed the part where he's trying to talk him down. He's like,
you know, I might be able to help you. Even more than you might think.
He's a sociology major.
Pre-law.
I remember seeing that the first time and thinking, law school, big mistake. But he really did say that, though. He thought that maybe he could talk him down and did try to say things like that. It's also true that as the scene continues, you're going to see that the killer, we're just going to call him the Zodiac killer from now on, he throws a rope over to Cecilia and tells him,
don't get up. I want her to tie you up. Okay.
And so she starts tying Brian up, tying his hands. And as he's doing this, the Zodiac comes over and he tightens the rope on Brian's hands. And then he starts tying Cecilia up. Like, he's going to leave them there after he takes all their stuff. And as he's doing this, he's giving them some random information. And Brian couldn't remember exactly what he said. He said he thought he said maybe Montana or Colorado. He broke out of prison and killed a prison guard.
I killed a guard escaping from prison in Montana.
I'm not doing anything, okay?
I'm not afraid to kill again. Look away.
So Brian was trying to keep him talking to get more information out of him and was asking,
what was the name of that prison? Hey, you said it was in Montana, right?
It's also true, and it's very clear in the movie, you think that he's just going to take their stuff and leave.
I'm taking your car. I'm going to Mexico.
And yeah. Brian even says to him,
we didn't complain when you tied our hands. Okay, you have everything that I have. We have done everything that you've asked. It's okay.
She tied you loose, didn't she? Get on your stomach so I can tie your feet.
Okay. It gets really cold out here at night. We could freeze.
And then he looks at him and he sees he's got this gun and he said,
you know, just because people are going to ask, was that thing even loaded?
And the Zodiac killer opens the gun and shows him it was loaded. But everybody's pretty relaxed at that point. And then out of nowhere, the Zodiac killer starts stabbing Brian in the back. And Brian describes after so many stabs, he just pretended to be dead to make him stop. Mm-hmm. And it worked. And then he went on over to Cecilia. And Cecilia did not pretend to be dead. She kept fighting. And so the Zodiac killer kept stabbing her until she was significantly more injured than Brian was. And then he leaves.
And I saw part of an interview with Brian, and he said that that scene of Cecilia moving around and getting stabbed, that's the flashback he has in his mind. So to him, that was a very accurate depiction of what actually happened.
Yeah. And both Brian Hartnell and Michael Mageau did not want this movie to be made. Michael Mageau ultimately never became involved with it, but Brian Hartnell did. He became an advisor for it. He was there the day that they did do this scene. He was very nervous at first and said it was very, very hard for him at first. He could not watch it, but he said, that if all people to do this movie, he was glad it was David Fincher because he saw that he was going to do it accurately. And the way they did do that scene was extremely accurate. You pointed this out. You'll notice that in the last two murders that have taken place, Lake Berryessa, murder number three, the one we're talking about now, and in murder number two, the July 4th murder, Lake Herndon Road, both the women die, but the men survive. Some people took this to be that psychologically, the Zodiac killer hated women, which I do see. I mean, I'm sure that's probably contributes to it. But I think especially in the Lake Berryessa case, I think Brian's reaction just made him literally think he had died or he was passed out or unconscious sooner. So he stopped stabbing him.
That's what I think. I think the Zodiac thought that he killed the guys in both two and three and just didn't finish the job all the way. Because in two, he actually goes back to shoot Mike again when he sees that Mike's moving. And then in three, Brian is, like you said, Brian was playing dead. So
yeah,
I think he just thought that he had finished the job and he hadn't really.
What happens next? In our next scene, we get another mysterious 911 call to the police. This call was made at 7:40 p.m. on September 27th, just after the killing had happened. It's the killer calling. He is called the Napa County Sheriff's Office.
Napa Police Department. I want to report a murder. No, a double murder. They are 2 miles north of Parkin headquarters. They were in a white Volkswagen Carmen-Gia. I'm the one that did it.
As we're hearing the voiceover of this 911 call, we are also seeing Brian's car that he has parked up the hill away from the lake. And the Zodiac killer has written a message in black ink on the car. It's the gun sight Zodiac symbol. And it says Vallejo 12-20-68 7-4-69. And then it says September 27th-69-630 by 9. So he's essentially taken ownership for this killing that he's just done and the two others that happened previously that he wrote about in the letters.
And another one where you see it on the passenger side door, I think, and you see this image of the writing, and that looks exactly like the photograph that was actually taken at the crime scene.
And one interesting thing about when this phone call was made, this 911 call, it was 27 miles from the crime scene, but it was only a couple of blocks from the Napa County Sheriff's Office. And people speculate that the reason the Zodiac killer did this is he knew that if he called the police in the area where Lake Berryessa was, they were going to set a perimeter and he wouldn't be able to get out. So he purposely went way, way out and almost taunted the police by making it closer to them than to where Lake Berryessa was. And the way that they found these two people was actually because a father and son were fishing and heard them screaming. So I think there was also some time pressure. He knew that people were going to hear them. There were other people around and he had to get out faster.
Yeah. And even though the father and son called it in, Brian said that it took over an hour for the ambulance to get to them. And then it took another hour to get to the hospital.
And when they found them, Cecilia was actually conscious. She was conscious in the ambulance and she was able to give a description of what she saw. Brian was as well. However, Cecilia, by the time she got to the hospital, fell into a coma and she never came out of the coma. She died 2 days later. He is ultimately going to be described as a white male, 5'10", 170 pounds with greasy brown hair. So after we see the Lake Berryessa murder, we're back at the San Francisco Chronicle and it looks like Robert Graysmith and Paul Avery are kind of getting to know each other better. Or they're at least talking to each other a little bit more. It's particularly about the Zodiac. And you see Robert Graysmith have this light bulb moment where he runs and he figures out what that dangerous animal reference he was talking about earlier was.
I knew it. Man's the most dangerous animal of all. I knew that. I heard that from somewhere. The most dangerous game. It's a movie about a count who hunts people for sport. People. The most dangerous game.
Who's that? That's the...
That's
the
Count Zaroff.
Zaroff? With a Z?
It is a reference to a book that's called The Most Dangerous Game. It was also published under the name The Hounds of Zaroff. It's by a guy named Richard Connell. And this was a book that was frequently read by students in high school at that time. It was also made into a movie in 1932 by the same name.
I definitely read it in high school. Did you read it?
No.
I didn't. I still had old school education, I guess.
Did you watch the movie too?
Yeah.
Well, damn it. I'm just behind. The story is essentially that some people get shipwrecked on an island, and this person, he's a count, saves them. He looks like this aristocrat. He's very nice at first, but then all of a sudden they realize that this man is going to hunt them. He's tired of hunting animals, so he is going to hunt humans. So this reference is in reference to the fact that hunting man is the most dangerous game, and that is what he is doing. So that's a mind fuck for you.
Yeah.
We also are getting a voiceover of the radio talking about these murders that have now happened, because it's very clear they're all connected. They're very clearly a pattern. They're all lovers' lane situations. It's always couples. And they're all in small rural towns.
And that will be all for the news on the 20. We've got curfews in effect tonight for the following counties: Napa, Solano, Contra Costa, Alameda, Marin, and San Mateo. So please, everyone, stay safe.
As we're listening to this voiceover radio, we're actually getting a bird's eye view of downtown San Francisco, and you hear people talking on the radio about how they're not worried about the Zodiac Killer because he's out in these rural areas. He's not in San Francisco. It's nothing for them to worry about.
Vic in San Francisco, you're on the line. You're not scared of the Zodiac?
Heck no, he's only shooting those farm kids. What scares me is those hippies out in the hate with their free-loving weird clothes.
As this is happening, we see someone get picked up in a cab. And again, we're in this bird's eye view. And the cab is going farther and farther out of downtown San Francisco, and it's going into a neighborhood. This neighborhood is called Presidio Heights. And as the car comes to a stop, we see that the person in the back pulls up a gun and just shoots the cabbie point blank. It's over. He's dead. We also then see, almost like now at this point, we're a neighbor viewing the cab through our window. We are looking at this scene where the person in the back gets out of the car, walks around the cab, opens the front passenger seat, and he's doing something inside the front passenger seat, but we can't tell what it is. And you also at this time are hearing actual people calling the police saying that they've seen something.
San Francisco Police Department?
Yep, there's a fate in a cab.
What is your location?
3398 Washington, at the corner of Church. One son, can we think he's robbing
is
him?
Is the crime still in progress?
Yes, please hurry.
Spoiler alert, this is the Zodiac Killer, but this is very unusual at this point. They don't know it's the Zodiac Killer because it's not how his other crimes have been.
Right.
All the other crimes have been couples in lovers' lane areas. This is a cab driver in the middle of the city, so they seem to think that this was some sort of robbery, and it's a really high-end neighborhood for an area to have something like that. It's very unusual.
Mm-hmm. And the cab driver was only on his third fare of the night, so he only had $8 or something. Like, he didn't have a lot of money from cab rides.
This is going to be murder number 4, or the Presidio Heights murder. Now, this is also the time that we are going to be introduced to our San Francisco PD detectives. They are two of our other main people. The first one's name is Dave Toschi, and he is played by our very favorite Mark Ruffalo. His phone rings. He's on call because he's a homicide detective, and he freaks out as his phone rings and breaks the lamp in his bedroom.
Nuts. Whoever this is, you owe me a new lamp.
Cabby's been shot 3 blocks from the Presidio.
Well, it wasn't me. I've been with my bride all night. She can vouch.
Go put on the Folgers.
You'll pick me up?
Let me just describe the lamp you're going to buy me.
And his wife is completely unfazed by this. She's just like, I'll go get the coffee. It's fine.
Yeah.
And he is being told by his partner over the phone that there has been a murder. A cabby's been shot and they need to go over to the scene. Toschi is then picked up by his partner, whose name is Bill Armstrong, who's played by Anthony Edwards. And immediately, this is one of my favorite things about this movie, those little moments that you see between coworkers that are with each other all the time. Without even any prompting, Bill Armstrong hands Dave Toschi a package of animal crackers.
I just got to sleep.
Suspects, Negro male adult, waltz on scene, locked off the cab and secured the crowd.
Seriously, got to sleep. I lost feeling in my arm and everything.
Crackers.
And that was actually a real thing. Dave Toschi was always eating animal crackers because he felt like he didn't have time to eat anything else. So cold coffee and animal crackers were his go-to when he was really busy. So he's eating the animal crackers. They've clearly been working together for forever. And this is just a regular thing. Bill Armstrong drives the car. He picks Toschi up. Then they go to the scene. That's how they work things. And one thing we hear as they're driving over is that there was a potential suspect that was seen that was a black male. So we get to the scene, and I didn't think about this until I was actually doing more research reading the book, but you notice that there's so many people around. There's people taking pictures, there's neighbors. In reality, there were so many people around this scene. Neighbors poking their head into the cab, news outlets taking pictures, in addition to just the people from the police department taking photos. Like, there was a lot of people, and it's not really thought about or mentioned, but it was very possible that this scene got contaminated. When they arrive at the scene, this is the first time we learn that the suspect that has at this point been described as a black male was not a black male at all. It was a white male.
Any witnesses?
Kids who called it in saw the suspect from that window.
Did they hear a shot?
No. We first saw him in the front seat, thought he was a drunk fighting with the driver. Oldest kid ran downstairs to get a better look from the dining room. Described him as a white male, glasses, crew cut, stocky, wearing a dark jacket.
Wait, I thought someone said he was black.
That's the description that went out to radio cars.
We already corrected it.
Oh, well, that's good.
So let's get into kind of what happened in this murder and who this victim was. The victim's name was Paul Stein. He was 29 years old. He was a student as well as a cab driver. He picked up somebody at a movie theater in downtown San Francisco and was instructed, according to his little cab book, to drive into Presidio Heights at the corner of a different street. For some reason, he ended up dropping off or stopping the cab at Washington and Cherry Street. So it was one block off. And we don't know if that's because maybe the Zodiac killer told him to move up because he saw witnesses, or if maybe he had him stop and then put a gun to him and told him to drive up one block, but he has him drive up one block to Washington and Cherry Street. Immediately as he stops the car, he shoots him in the back of the head. And this is a little gory, but there was a lot of blood. So after he shoots him, there were three teenagers that actually heard a commotion and came out and looked and called 911 saying, it looks like a guy was getting in a fight with a cabbie and that one of them might have been drunk. And the kids are freaking out. And the dispatcher is trying to take the information from these kids and relay it to some police officers in the area. And there were two police officers on patrol, and they kept asking, can you give us a description? And the dispatcher would say, I'm trying to get one. These are kids. They're panicking. Give me a second. And somehow in the midst of all this, another dispatch interfered, and it was misinterpreted that it was a black male, not a white male, even though none of those kids ever said that. And it was not corrected until much later. So when they do get to the cab, they are going to see that a bloody fingerprint has been left on the handle in the cab, supposedly by this killer. So they have one fingerprint. They know that there's a bullet and a casing that's been left, and he was shot with a 9mm. And at this point, the police think that this is a robbery. And they continue to think it's a robbery until October 13th, 1969, we get letter number 5 to the San Francisco Chronicle.
This is the Zodiac speaking. I am the murderer of the taxi driver over by Washington Street and Maple Street last night. To prove this, here is a bloodstained piece of his shirt. I am the same man who did in the people in the North Bay area. The SF police could have caught me last night if they had searched the park properly instead of holding road races with their motorcycles.
And in this letter, there is a piece of a bloody shirt that they later determine is a piece of Paul Stein's shirt with blood on it. So that's what he was doing when he went up to the front of the passenger side. He takes responsibility for the shooting of Paul Stein. And the other thing that he says in this letter is that he is threatening to shoot up children coming off of a school bus.
Read the last part.
School children make nice targets. I think I shall wipe out a school bus some morning, just shoot out the front tire,
and then pick off the kitties as they come bouncing out.
And there's a big debate as to whether or not they publish this letter and if they're going to publish this part about the bus. And a lot of people mm-hmm. do not want to publish the part about the bus because they don't want people to get in a panic. To which my answer was, I think it's time to panic.
Yeah.
So the San Francisco Chronicle decides,
in cooperation with SFPD, we will run the Zodiac letter without including the threat on school children. We don't want to start a citywide panic, so I'm asking all of you to please keep this confidential. Just go about your daily business. Thank you.
We see Graysmith coming up from the back and he's hearing this information and he's shocked by it. I mean, this is kids we're talking about. And of course, like clockwork, the very next scene is Graysmith getting his kid on the bus.
Pack your carrots and your celery and peanut butter, okay?
Dad, we don't have to wait today.
I know. You know what? You know what? I'm gonna drive him today, okay?
And he immediately pulls him off and says, I'll just drive him. I think they had a responsibility to publish that. I know they didn't want to cause panic, but that is scary.
Yeah.
This is also going to be when we meet our handwriting expert. And his name is Sherwood Morrill. And he is looking at all of the Zodiac letters that we've gotten so far. And he is trying to determine, were these all written by the same person? And as he's examining them, you see Dave Toschi clearly getting in his way. And he's like, you need to go wait in the hall, dude. Let me do my work.
What's that?
Similarities in the lowercase r's.
And that?
It is you waiting in the hall. If you speak again, I have to concentrate.
Sorry,
counts as speaking.
And Toschi goes to wait in the hall, and there's a little argument between Toschi and Armstrong about what do we do about this threat? Do we tell the public about this or not? And Armstrong says,
we have to release the bus threat.
It'll screw us.
We're already screwed. We just went from routine cabbie shooting to mass murder targets kids.
Which I was like, yes, you need to tell people this. You right. absolutely need to tell people this. So after they have this brief little discussion, Sherwood Morrill walks out and you see a very grim face on him. And he is basically there to tell him, this is the same guy. This is legit. And it is after yeah. this that they publish this bus threat on October 17th, 1969. And we see Robert Graysmith with this kid watching it on TV and them talking about the bus threat that was made.
The Zodiac killer has come to San Francisco. Confirmation tonight from the San Francisco Police Department that in his latest haunting letter, which takes credit for the murder of cab driver Paul Stein, the Zodiac has threatened to, quote, wipe out a school bus and pick off the kiddies as they come bouncing out.
You also are starting to get the feeling of how difficult this was for all these agencies involved. And I feel like it's very common for crime movies or movies about police officers to make it seem like police officers or police agencies are always trying to hide their evidence from other agencies. And that's not true. They just don't want it being made public. And that was kind of the case here. They were just trying to coordinate. We see Armstrong on the phone with people from the other agencies where other murders have happened. So, for example, right. Paul Stein was killed in San Francisco. So San Francisco PD is in charge of his murder and getting the evidence. The July 4th murder was in Vallejo, so they need to talk to Vallejo PD. The Lake Berryessa murder was in Napa, so they got to talk to the Napa County Sheriff's Office. And all of this is causing confusion for Armstrong and these other agencies because, number one, they got to figure out who do they talk to? Which agency is in charge of what murder? Because it all depends on right. location. Number two, what evidence do you have and can you send it to me? And then you get into a technology issue of they're talking about faxing and mailing stuff over, and some of them don't have faxes to fax the things over. So it's just taking yeah. forever. And in the midst of all of this mess, we have Armstrong get interrupted and two patrol cops walk in and they're in so much trouble.
Yeah.
These two cops, they actually were not in trouble in real life. Here's what's happened. These are the two cops that were on patrol at the time that Paul Stein was murdered that initially got the dispatch that it was a black male they were looking for. And they did see a white male. They very possibly saw the person they were looking for, but it was too dark and they let him go. They didn't stop him.
Listen, dispatch said it was a Negro male.
That was corrected. No, but at the time they hadn't changed it.
This guy was white. Right, not in a hurry, kind of lumbering along.
Lumbering? What do you mean lumbering?
Shuffling.
Stocky? Had a crew cut?
Yeah, that's all correct.
And we're going to learn in a later letter that Zodiac actually comments on the fact that he was stopped and talked to by two officers, and it was these two officers. Now, the movie shows them as being in really big trouble for letting this guy go, that this was the closest they ever got to catching the Zodiac. In reality, the police department knew there were two guys on patrol that had, number one, been in that area, and number two, had talked to someone. And Dave Toschi even says later, he was like, I wasn't mad at them. I just wanted to talk to them to know what they saw. It was not their fault. It was the wrong description. But they did kind of linger. I think they waited a few days just because I think, number one, they said they were really shook up that this happened, that they got that close to this murderer. But number two, I think they were a little afraid they were going to get in trouble. And the reality was they were not in trouble. So after we have Paul Stein's murder and the bus threat has been made public, on October 22nd, 1969, we see Dave Toschi being woken up in the middle of the night by Armstrong as they're on call.
Yeah.
Someone claiming to be Zodiac called Oakland PD a half hour ago. He says he's going to call in on Jim Dunbar's morning show in 3 hours.
On television?
He wants Melvin Belleye on to counsel him.
All right. Let's go wake up Melvin.
And Armstrong is telling him that Oakland Police Department has gotten a call from somebody claiming to be the Zodiac Killer. And he is going to call into the Jim Dunbar morning show. And he wants either Melvin Belleye, who is a famous torts attorney, or F. Lee Bailey, a famous criminal defense attorney, to be on the show so he can talk to them. He wants to talk to them basically over the airwaves. And they don't mention F. Lee Bailey in the movie. You told me that he requested either one of those. He actually preferred F. Lee Bailey. And number one, F. Lee Bailey wasn't really available. But number two, they thought it might be better for the public to see Melvin Belleye because Melvin Belleye was randomly in one episode of Star Trek in 1968. So he kind of had this weird celebrity about him. So we see Toschi and Armstrong go and pick up Melvin Belleye. And Melvin Belleye is not in front of all the people yet. So he's panicking a little bit. We don't see him, but we hear him from the floorboard of the back seat of the cop car because he does not want to get shot.
Are these windows bulletproof?
Yes, Melvin. I left the lie down back there.
This man is a marksman, could snuff me out at a moment's notice.
Are you sure you're up for this?
Don't you worry about me, Inspector. I'll be fine when the lights are on. This man has asked for my help.
The man you're worrying about snuffing you out?
What are these? Cookies? Dear Lord, do you ever clean this car?
And they're like, are you sure you're up for this? And he's like, no, once I'm in front of the people, I'll be good. Which I feel like a lot of attorneys are like that. I cannot keep calm. I am panicking at all times. But some people, when they're not in front of the client, they are so different than when they are with them.
That's true.
That I thought that was hilarious. So they're getting ready to go on the morning show. And we see Armstrong telling Melvin Belleye, if you can, get him to meet us at the specific spot in Chinatown.
Get him talking, convince him to meet you somewhere. If you see an opportunity, we want you to suggest Old St. Mary's Church in Chinatown.
You'll be tracing the call.
Pacific Telephone says you need to keep him on the line for 15 minutes.
We can do that, can't we, Jim?
The show starts. Jim Dunbar explains what they are doing, and they have somebody call in.
Roll the tape. Get the tape.
Jim, we have a call. We're going live.
Hello? Hello, this is Melvin Belleye. Who am I speaking with?
This is the Zodiac speaking.
And the person says that they are the Zodiac. Melvin Belleye asks,
is there something I can call you that's a little less ominous?
Sam.
And he says, well, what can I do for you? Do you need help? And he says he has health problems, but he does not have mental problems. He says he gets headaches.
Sam, do you think you need medical care?
Medical, not mental.
Do you have health problems?
I'm sick. I have headaches.
Headaches?
And he says he does not want to go to the gas chambers.
Sam, you need to tell me what your problem is.
I don't want to go to the gas chamber. I have headaches. I don't get them.
All of a sudden, he hangs up, and they are trying to get him back on the line. They are worried that he's thinking that they're going to trace the call, so they actually lie to him on the air, and they say, we're not tracing this call, so Sam calls back. In reality, they had him calling and hanging up several times. They only show him call and hang up twice. I can't imagine watching this live. He screams.
How long have you been having these headaches?
Since I killed a kid. I don't want to be hurt.
Why is he calling?
I don't want to go to the gas chamber.
You won't get hurt if you talk to me.
You're not going to the gas chamber.
I wouldn't think they would ask for capital punishment.
We should ask the district attorney. Do you want me to do that, Sam? Do you want me to talk to the district attorney?
And Melvin Bella asks him, what was that? I mean, it sounds like someone is hurt.
Well, what was that, Sam?
I did not say anything.
We heard a scream.
That was my headache.
I would be so fucking scared. Oh my God. And so Melvin Bella asks him, is there a place we can meet? What if we meet at this Chinatown location, the one he suggested? He says, no. I want to meet at this other place.
Yeah. And the place that the guy wants to meet is the Daly City St. Vincent de Paul thrift shop. And I actually lived in Daly City for a little bit, so I'm positive my dad has gone thrifting there. He has to have.
Yes. And they even have it in the background. I wonder if that was the real thing. Oh, that's cool. Anyways, they hang up the phone and they immediately go to this location. And it is the world's worst secret meeting you could possibly imagine. Melvin Belli gets out of the car and he's like,
My. You fellows certainly know how to put on a secret meeting.
As a helicopter is going over his head and news people are everywhere.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert, Zodiac Killer does not show up. And they have people who have previously spoken to the Zodiac Killer, including Brian Hartnell, who was the survivor of the Lake Berryessa murder, and the two dispatchers, the first one from Vallejo PD and the other one from Napa, when the Zodiac Killer called the police, listened to the voice of the person calling on the TV, and they said, no, he sounds too young. The Zodiac Killer was older and he was more gruff. And then we get two letters in a row. The first one is on November 8th, and this is letter number 6, and it's to the San Francisco Chronicle. And this is the first artistic letter the Zodiac Killer sends. It's like almost a card. It's got a picture of a pen that's dripping on the front. And this one includes a cipher, and this cipher was 340 characters, and it was not solved until December 5th of 2020. So for almost 50 years, it went unsolved. And what this cipher said actually relates specifically back to this newscast. And it confirms for us that the caller to the Oakland PD and to the TV show was not the Zodiac. He never called any of those people. And it also gets more creepy because one of the big things that the person that called in said, he kept saying that he didn't want to go to the gas chambers. And what the cipher says is that it was not him on the TV. And it brings up a point about me. I am not afraid of the gas chambers because it will send me to paradise all the sooner because now I have enough slaves to work for where everyone else has nothing. So the cipher just clarifies the Zodiac Killer is fucking scary and he was not that person on TV. Now in the movie, they show Armstrong telling Toschi that they have traced the call and figured out that this was actually a person in a mental health hospital. He was a patient. It is true they do figure that out, but they don't figure that out till much later that it was this guy. It was like, I think maybe a year later that they finally determined it was a mental patient. Then we get another letter and the movie combines these letters, but we get another letter the very next day on November 9th, 1969. This is letter number 7. And this letter is 6 pages long. And the Zodiac is just pissed in this one. He says that he is no longer going to announce when he commits his murders. They're going to look like random acts of violence.
So I shall change my way of collecting slaves. I shall no longer announce to anyone when I commit my murders. They shall look like routine robberies, killings of anger, and a few fake accidents, etc.
He said that the description people are saying of him when he is, quote, doing his thing is not what he looks like in real life, so you'll never be able to find him.
I look like the description passed out only when I do my thing. The rest of the time, I look entirely different. I shall not tell you what my disguise consists of when I kill.
He also says that the police have not found any fingerprints of his at any crime scenes, because at this point, people know that there's been a fingerprint at the Paul Stein scene. And he says that he has been able to cover up his fingerprints by basically putting glue on the tips of his fingers so that you can't see them.
As of yet, I have left no fingerprints behind me. Contrary to what the police say, I wear transparent fingertips. All it is two coats of airplane cement coated on my fingertips.
And this is the letter where he talks about the two cops stopping him in Presidio Heights. Gotcha. Then the letter goes on to essentially list out a recipe for a bomb. And it has a picture of a bomb.
One bag of ammonium nitrate fertilizer, 1 gallon of stove oil, dump a few bags of gravel on top.
That's a bomb.
Okay, we got to call the Army and see if this science experiment could actually work.
And this bomb is apparently rigged to go off at the height of buses, but let other automobiles pass by. So he's still like raying on this school bus children threat.
And we also get a transition into a scene with Armstrong and Toschi speaking, and they are talking about the fact that he has mentioned a basement in his most recent letter as well.
Hello?
Bill. There's not many basements in California.
Basement for future use.
That's right.
I'll have Vallejo and Napa check with their city planners.
And this is a big clue that they pick up on because there's not that many basements in California. So they're like, okay, this will narrow it down.
Then we see Avery and Graysmith are now kind of bonding. They're at a bar together where Graysmith is drinking what looks like the most delicious drink. It's called an Aqua Velva. It's a blue tropical drink. And Paul Avery is just like, what the hell?
This can no longer be ignored. What is that you're drinking?
It's an Aqua Velva. I wouldn't make fun of it if you tried it.
Five Aqua Velvas in for both of them, and they are talking all about the Zodiac Killer and ciphers and how Graysmith solved the first cipher. And he basically explains to him, we get a really good explanation as to how he was able to decode this cipher. And the first cipher was much easier because the first cipher, it had everything to do with just substituting letters.
What's the most common double consonant in the English language?
Consonant?
The double L.
Double L.
And what's the one word that we know that he'll use in here at least once?
Kill.
Right, kill. So the Hardens start looking for double symbols, which they find here, here, and here, each with the same two symbols preceding them. So now they've got a repeating four-letter word ending with two symbols that they assume stand for L.
And since I think the whole word is kill.
And you got your K, you got your I, and you're on your way.
But then it gets more complicated when you start substituting symbols. And Graysmith's a bookworm, so he went to the library and he found several different books. One of them is a book on medieval coding, actually called the Zodiac Alphabet, and he is able to determine the rest of the coding. So that's what he's been working on. Next scene is actually at Christmas, and it is Dave Toschi and Armstrong going to Melvin Belli's house because Melvin Belli is the recipient of Zodiac's eighth letter. And in that letter, we have the second piece of Paul Stein's bloody shirt. Mm-hmm. And essentially what this letter is saying is that he is asking for help before he loses control and, quote, does his thing again. He says that all the time, saying, do my thing is his way of saying killing people.
Dear Melvin, this is the Zodiac speaking. I wish you a happy Christmas. The one thing I ask of you is this, please help me. I cannot reach out for help because this thing in me won't let me, thank you. I am finding it extremely difficult to hold it in check, and I'm afraid I will lose control again and take my ninth and possibly tenth victim.
Melvin, he's reaching out to you.
Absolutely. Inspectors, he sent this letter directly to my residence.
They kind of shrink this down for time. What actually happened in this case was that Melvin Belli was out of town for weeks and his employees sent him the letter. He would eventually talk with the police about this and he had them send it to authorities right away, but he was not home at Christmas to receive this thing. The other thing is at this scene, you're going to notice that he says that the Zodiac called his house and he's going to say that one of his housekeepers answered the phone.
When did the letter arrive?
In the middle of last week. It is my belief that he only penned this letter because he couldn't get through to me on the Dunbar show or here.
He tried to contact you here?
Several times I was out and spoke with my housekeeper.
This is going to become, and I didn't realize this at first, a big point of contention for people. Not everybody thinks that the person that called the house was the Zodiac, and there's a big contention as to the date that he called. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit later, but just know that in this span over Christmas, Melvin Belli has received a call and a letter from the Zodiac Killer. Ultimately, this is going to be the last time the Zodiac Killer ever tries to write him. He never does again. However, the guy in the mental hospital that wanted Melvin Belli on the phone for the morning show, he actually develops this really weird obsession with him and keeps trying to contact him.
Oh,
so
no.
Melvin Belli was really getting the bad end of the stick on this thing. All right, guys, we are going to stop right here and pick up where we left off in part two of Zodiac next week. Please, please, please rate, review, and subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. And you can follow us on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook at Crime Scenes Pod. And we have a new thing that I mentioned earlier called Buy Me a Coffee.
Yeah, so it is called buymeacoffee.com. You can find our page at buymeacoffee.com/crimescenespod. We've also posted a bit on our social media. It's basically just an easy way to support us as we keep making podcasts. We hope in the future we'll actually be able to enjoy some coffee with our listeners. But for now, if you want to send us a virtual cup of coffee, that would be greatly appreciated.
Yeah, we've gotten a lot of feedback talking about how they like the sound in the show and stuff like that, but it does take time. So this is basically a way to contribute. And of course, we'll give you a shout out and keep the show as good as it has been. So yeah, go ahead and check that out. And that's it. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye.
I feel like I'm going to have a good day because it's 7 a.m. and I'm starting my day talking about the Zodiac Killer.
As the scene opens, we get... I got a chickpea stuck in my nose yesterday. Oh, no. Anyway, it's gone now. But fun fact. As the scene opens, we get... Fuck. I also don't know very much about guns. So if I'm saying 9mm and you're like, 9mm what? What does that mean? That just... Sorry.